Hey everybody, welcome to Pilot Lounge. With me today, Jared Isaacman. So Jared, you have a fascinating aviation background, but as kind of a fellow space nut and a kid who was inspired by the Apollo program, I want to jump right to your recent space flight where you were the commander and benefactor on Inspiration 4, the SpaceX flight in September that went higher than any crewed flight had gone in some 20 years. And in the process of that flight, you raised $240 million for St. Jude's Children's Research Center. I was down in Florida last year when the first SpaceX flight with Americans went into space, and it was fascinating to see that thing go. So I got to know, what was it like being in the Dragon capsule when that Falcon 9 was lit? Tell us about it.
It was really an incredible experience. So, when you first get strapped into Dragon, they build in quite a bit of margin in the schedule for just things that can break that you need to fix. So you actually are strapped in, over really 2 hours before liftoff. And if everything goes smooth, as it did for us, you're really sitting there and it doesn't look like time is moving at all. And then when you get within 45 minutes of liftoff, that's when you arm the launch escape system and you start the propellant load. So a little different, like when the space shuttle was fully fueled before the astronauts would ever get on board.
Right.
Dragon, you're strapped in as the LOX and the RP-1 is flowing into the first and second stage. So you can feel Dragon and Falcon coming alive, the grumbling and the valves opening and the vibrations.
Wow.
And then it slows down again. And then the last couple minutes before liftoff, that clock is just spinning. And the next thing you know, you're on your way uphill, and 10 minutes later, you're in orbit.
Yeah.
And it all happens very, very quickly.
Wow. What are the G loads like on the takeoff, liftoff?
Not bad at all. I mean, when you're coming off the pad, you're just better than, 1-to-1 thrust to weight. So as you can tell, when you see a rocket lift off, usually it doesn't move a whole lot at first, and then you start to see it really gradual and build up speed. So if you're not looking at the instruments, you really hardly know you're coming off the ground, but it only takes a matter of seconds before you start accelerating rather quickly. Your peak G loading on the way uphill is about 4.8 Gs, and that's towards the end of the second stage when you're really obtaining orbital velocity. It's mostly less than that, mostly really less than 3 on the way uphill until towards the end.
Yeah, and then weightlessness, what was that like?
Yeah, it's very different. We got a lot of pilots, I guess, kind of tuning in for this.
Right.
And it's like explaining to somebody what pulling G's is like. And, they'll say, well, I've driven race cars or I've been to amusement park rides. And you're like, it's not the same. that's what being in microgravity is like. There is absolutely nothing that can prepare you for how that feels. Because it's physiological as well. There's fluid shifts to your brain. You do feel differently, and it takes some time to almost acclimatize to it can take like a couple days actually. But you can be very happy and productive through it, but it is a different sensation.
Yeah. I read where the first moonrise you saw was kind of an aha moment for you. That was probably hard to prepare for too.
It was. That was probably, in terms of the surprises, a lot of astronauts refer to the overview effect and seeing the Earth as a, fragile place with a thin atmosphere and a world without borders and without violence. But I felt like I knew all those things without having to go to space. So when I saw the world from that vantage point, of course, it's super impressive and it radiates energy. But it wasn't until I saw that moonrise, just based on the altitude, we were able to see, the entirety of the Earth's sphere with the moon coming around it in space on all four corners. And I just wasn't expecting that at the moment. And it made me want to look more outward to all that we don't know and all that we have yet to explore and learn about our universe. And just the feeling that we need to get at it because we haven't made a whole lot of progress over the last 60 years.
Yeah, that is true. So Dragon was designed to be autonomous, yet you all trained for like almost a year to actually operate the thing and that sort of thing. As a pilot, did you ever get the desire to just click that autopilot off and drive that thing around a little bit?
Well, I mean, we trained for 6 months and you get certainly a lot of cracks at manual operations in the simulator. I mean, it's just like any other aviation training that we all go through. You know, the simulator is always the Apollo 13 scenario where, you know, the wing is barely attached and everything's going wrong. And it's a great opportunity to prove that, you know, to apply really all the knowledge that you've accumulated in training. But once you get into the real thing, most of the time the autopilots work right. And we had some alerts and some alarms and different issues that, you know, you should expect. It never is perfect. And we were flying at a much higher altitude with greater radiation exposure. So we had some radiation induced events on some of the systems. But like, this is why you have triple redundancy. And in the end, there was very few manual, you know, inputs that had to be done at all. But in the unlikely event something really did go wrong, you do have the manual means to come home and target a place to re-enter the atmosphere. And fortunately, everything was very nominal for us.
Yeah. Well, that's good news. Still must have been tempting.
If I could do it all over again, I think there are some things I would have done differently just to say I did. So.
Yeah. So you're up there about 3 days in orbit. Tell me about the reentry and the splashdown and how that go.
Yeah, reentry is definitely a much, you would think, or at least I would have thought, that like the highest blood pressure moment would be on liftoff and the uphill. Because I think just visually, whenever we think about rockets going wrong, it's usually right off the pad.
Sure.
And actually, that was an area where we were all smiling and very, very charged up and focused on our job, because there's actually quite a few outs. You know, unlike the shuttle program, we have a launch escape system. If Dragon or if I don't like something that's going on, or even Mission Control, we can separate Dragon from the Falcon very quickly. It's very safe. There's actually a number of things that can go wrong uphill that you can fix. But once you're committed downhill, you have very little control, because it's all in the thermal protection system, the heat shield, if you will. Like, mm-hmm. you're putting so much energy in that vehicle to go 17,500 miles an hour, and then you have to take it all out. And most of that happens as you impact the atmosphere. And it gets very hot, I mean, well over 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And if anything happens, and you'd have no idea, like if you just took a small micrometeorite or orbital debris and it takes a little chunk out of the heat shield in the right spot, it's a big problem. So I'd say like all of our, you know, blood pressure was a little higher. The G-forces are more, you know, they are higher and sustained longer. And your body is deconditioned. Even in 3 days of microgravity, you're not quite the same. So, but it's still exciting. It's exhilarating. And then when you splash down, it's like a little fender bender. It's not a big deal.
So you've had several months now since the flight back in September to kind of reflect on what it is that you did there. Any thoughts or observations on, you know, the role of space exploration on the human society and that sort of thing?
Well, I mean, we were always rather consistent from the beginning of Inspiration 4 that, you know, our job was really just to get it right so that there'd be a lot more interesting missions to follow. And you know, in that respect, I think we did it right. You know, it was the right crew that all had their own audience to reach out to and inspire. It was all done for the right reasons, not just about, you know, what's interesting in space, but what we can accomplish here on Earth. We raised a lot of money for a cause that's important for today that has nothing to do with space. I think that's important while space is expensive. And then we dedicated our time on orbit to research and science that hadn't really had a chance to be done before, and under like different circumstances. Like our altitude allowed us to do radiation research that will inform future long duration space flight. So I think we checked a lot of good boxes that again should allow a lot more interesting missions to follow. And that's what we set out to accomplish.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's go back in time a ways to your aviation experience. How did you get into aviation?
Well, I was always loved aviation. I mean, since I was a kid, I built like my 386 computer to play Falcon 3.0. You know, loved watching Top Gun, like I think all of us.
Yeah.
And you know, loved watching the movie Space Camp and the right stuff. And you dream about the idea that maybe someday you could go and journey among the stars. And I never felt that was actually possible, which is why I kind of gravitated towards what was, which was flying. And I started flying, I guess, about 18 years ago, and I just really never stopped. And it was, you know, I think it's challenging, it's therapeutic, it's just great in so many respects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what ratings do you hold at this point and certificates?
ATP for single, multi, CFI, II, MEI type ratings in various corporate jets and, experimental, like ex-military type aircraft, mm-hmm. and various formation acrobatic ratings.
Right. Okay. So you founded Shift for Payments at 16, still the CEO there, now processing hundreds of billions of dollars of electronic transactions per year. And so was there any intersection there between, you know, as a kid starting a company like that that's now got thousands of employees and your aviation experience? Did one help the other or one inspire the other?
Yeah, for sure. I still remember really clearly why I wanted to start flying and taking lessons. And basically, it had only been like 4 years after I started the company, and you know, I'm probably like 20 years old, and I'm waking up on my keyboard every morning, and I was like, I was actually burning myself out, and I was like, I need a hobby, I need something else in my life that's interesting and stimulating, and that's why I kind of say flying is therapeutic. Almost all my lessons early on were at night. I used to fly at night all the time because it was just an opportunity to clear your mind. There was no Wi-Fi in airplanes at that point. And then I used to fly everywhere for business reasons, anywhere I needed to go, and just progress very quickly from single to multi to jets. And then eventually the hobby, you know, grew into some philanthropic work, was able to do some flights to raise money for the Make-A-Wish Foundation, flew air shows with it, and that ultimately led to a whole new business. Nothing to do with my day job in payments, but, defense adversary work, basically flying as the bad guy for the military. So, you know, aviation has been more than just like a hobby and passion. It's really been a big part of my life on a professional and personal side.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that for a couple of minutes. In 2012, you co-founded Draken International, sometimes described as the world's largest private air force with some 151 tactical fighters and that sort of thing, where the company's providing, aggressor sort of services and a lot of other mission types of missions too, to militaries around the world. So how did that come about?
Yeah, it was, what a cool business. I mean, I think it's like, you know, there's commercial space and then there's like commercial fighter jets. It's right. Not that far off. It's very high on the cool factor.
Yeah, definitely.
So we were flying air shows. We did this, we had this, seven ship act at one point where we had five L-39s and two MiG-17s. We even had a T-33 we flew a bit. And I flew right wing on the team and I was one of the founders of the team. And, our big year was 2011 when, the Defense Department, you know, we were basically going through sequestration from a budget perspective, right. and all the demo teams couldn't fly. So we wound up flying every weekend for like 9 months.
Wow.
And it was an amazing experience. But, it was very high risk flying. You know, we were flying with like 3 feet of wing overlap, 18 inches of vertical separation. And even though we all did well, it was very safe. You just felt like this isn't sustainable. This is very high risk. There's got to be a way to pivot this into something more commercial. And then we started kind of traveling around the world and just buying entire fleets of fighter jets from countries, Poland, Czech Republic, South Africa, Spain, New Zealand. And we assembled this, like one of the world's largest air forces, really solely for the purpose of training the U.S. military as like a sparring partner. And mm-hmm. What an adventure.
Right. That's it sure sounds like what a fascinating collection of airplanes. You had access to fly some or all of them at some point in there. What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, I had been flying A4 Skyhawk since 2008. So, my familiarity with that platform is what actually led us to our first purchase, which was the New Zealand A4 Skyhawks.
Mm-hmm.
Just as cool as what you saw in Top Gun, but they had an F-16 radar in it and they had some other advanced avionics. So very familiar, flew a lot of A4s and newer models that we wound up buying later on, like the Super Fox, the N model. But yeah, I pretty much was rated and flew every type of jet that we had at Draken, with the exception of the Mirage F1, which really came on after I left the organization.
Right. Yep. So what do you currently own and fly?
So I fly a MiG-29. I'm very lucky to operate that. It's a beast. I mean, it's the highest performance airplane I've ever flown.
Wow.
Fly L-39s, Alpha jets, business jets like CJ-3 and, other jets in the Citation family and such.
Yeah. A favorite?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd still like the A4N Skyhawk was always my favorite. It had a motor that was 20% more than like the biggest A4 motor that was typically deployed. And it was very light. So a clean A4N with like half internal fuel had better than 1-to-1 thrust to weight ratio. So it was like, I mean, it was a hot rod. But I like flying the MiG-29 an awful lot too. So.
Yeah. And so you've set you alluded to this earlier. You've set a couple of speed records, including the one for charity, at least. What was that about, and how did that come about?
Yeah, so it was 2008 and 2009. I had a Citation Mustang. It's like one of the first VLJs. Mm-hmm. And just thought it'd be cool with, new glass cockpits that were just fusing information together that, what about like flying around the world where you can't flight plan in a traditional sense. You've got to just use all the onboard information available to do it and try and set a speed record. Now, like this to me was just like super fascinating, challenging, interesting, just something I personally wanted to try and accomplish. But like other of these adventures I've been fortunate enough to go on, you want to make it about something, bigger than yourself. So the idea is we could do this challenge and also raise money for the Make-A-Wish Foundation. So did that in 2008. We came up short. We would have beaten it, but we got held up in a couple countries just due to regulatory issues. And then in the next year, we did it again with a CJ-2, which was also in the same weight category. So it had some advantages because you get a little bit more range and speed. But we beat the record by 24 hours.
Wow.
And it was, and we bypassed all the countries we had issues with in the prior year. So I saw a lot of cool parts of the world for about 5 minutes. Yep. and raised a bunch of money for Make-A-Wish along the way. So
yeah.
That was cool.
Yeah. Well, clearly aviation has been an important part of your life and made a big impact on your life. What would you say to somebody you run into, maybe a kid somewhere who's contemplating learning to fly, maybe an aviation career? What would you say?
I think it's fantastic. Whether or not you choose to make a career in it, I just think that you get an awful lot about aviation. I mean, there's good, structure and discipline and just a thought process on how you go through things. I mean, I try and teach around here my day job how checklist discipline leads to good outcomes, and failing to adhere to like a procedural driven philosophy is how you have mistakes. So like there's a lot that you can just learn that aviation teaches us that you can apply to other aspects of your life. It opens up opportunities and new and like exciting regimes, like whether it's commercial space flight or supporting the commercial space industry or like aerospace medicine. I mean, satellites, cyber, avionics. There's just a lot of good things that can develop from it. So aside from just being like able to, fly like the birds, if you will, and like, leave the world we're normally bound to, like there's a lot of exciting elements to it over and above that I think are great for young people to get exposed to, and who knows what kind of an influence it can have on their life going forward.
Right. So what's next for you? You've been further from the surface of the earth than anybody had been for quite a number of years. And so done a lot of interesting stuff. Where do you go from here?
I think I'm really fortunate. I'm connected to three organizations that I love very much. So my day job in Shift 4 that I've been doing for 22 years, I've been able to take an awful lot away from my exposure to an amazing company like SpaceX and bring it here and help us do things differently more innovation. So I think future is really, really bright with my day job. I'm still very connected to St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. So just ran in their half marathon this past weekend. Mm. I'm married to that organization for the rest of my life. Like, that mission is never over until, you know, no child dies in the dawn of life. So we'll continue to raise awareness and funds for them. And I'm fortunate to be very close to SpaceX in a number of respects. And they are changing the world and making science fiction more reality by the day. So I intend to stay close with all three organizations.
Mm-hmm. Does that suggest there's another space flight in your future?
We'll have to see.
Okay. All right. Jared, thanks so much for taking time to share your story with us. Fascinating, and good luck on your next adventure.
Oh, thank you so much. Thanks for the time today. It's great.